Hi, welcome to JaffeWoodwinds.com, and today we're with one of the greatest tenor players and flute players in the jazz world, and actually in any world. Lew Tabackin is a virtuoso on both instruments and has been a major force in the music industry for now well over 50 years. And we're honored to be at Lew's home here in Manhattan and to spend this next hour or so with Lew. Lew, thanks so much for doing this. I appreciate you taking
My
the time
pleasure,
out of your day. And this is long overdue because we've started this video series about 2 years ago, and it's I should have had you here much sooner, but I'm so thankful that you're able to do this with us today. And I wanted to just start off, because there's been so much information available online and on your site, lewtabackin.com. I just want to touch on a few basics for the folks who are tuning in today about how you got started growing up in Philadelphia, first playing flute and then tenor saxophones. And Philadelphia in those days was such a vibrant musical community with the Philadelphia Orchestra right in the middle of it and a great jazz scene. So can you talk about how you got started playing flute, your first instrument, and then shortly thereafter tenor saxophone?
Well, kind of a very strange reality. I decided it as an early teenager that I would like to play something. And there was no music in my family. Nobody played anything. And I don't know why, I thought maybe I should try. And I thought, well, maybe, I didn't know anything. I thought maybe a clarinet would be cool, you know? So I go to school program in Philadelphia, public school system, they would loan you instruments. So no clarinet. The only thing they had was a flute. Now three people were trying out for the flute, and their criterion was whoever can get a sound out of the head joint would get the instrument.
Right.
This one guy did really good. He got a pretty big sound. I got a little feeble little sound, and the girl didn't want it. So, and then the guy who got a better sound didn't want it either. Because if you realize, growing up in South Philadelphia, you don't play a flute. I mean, you can play a trumpet. You play a
right for a guy in those days.
Yeah,
that was a different
anyway.
Ball
I didn't even know what it was, right. So I took it. And unfortunately, which is a horrible thing, you should be aware of this, that I had a terrible teacher. Whoever they signed to teach me was obviously didn't know what a flute was either. He was, and if you could believe this person that was going around to schools teaching instrumental stuff didn't know anything about the flute. I was playing the flute like this. Now, I didn't know the difference. So I had the flute on my shoulder. The only B flat I knew was a thumb B flat.
Yeah. Well, you're holding it like a violin, in essence.
It was so horrible.
Yeah.
And I didn't know.
Yeah.
It was I never had seen a flute player. So that was my introduction to the music world.
Right.
So it took me years and years and years to unlearn all this stuff. So eventually I took a couple lessons, and they had a settlement school where it was, we had no money in our family, which was subsidized, and you could take some lessons. And I started to do a little better, but played in the school orchestra, quote unquote. So that was how I got started. It wasn't a very auspicious beginning, and I wasn't really serious. And then eventually, actually, I did get a clarinet. Not a very good one, but I got I think it was a Wurlitzer or something. Does that make any sense?
Well, Wurlitzer, but Wurlitzers also have a different fingering system than the traditional
system.
Oh, okay, it was.
Anyway, I started to play a little bit of clarinet. And anyway, so that was my beginning. And then when I was 15, I went into high school, and I saw after orchestra rehearsal, people would be jamming and stuff. And before that, I had a neighbor who had a jazz record collection. And in those days, jazz music was very popular amongst the quote-unquote college kids and stuff. This is 1955. So I admired this guy, he let me listen to his records. There's some flute players. And so I go to high school, and I decided to get a tenor saxophone. Around Philadelphia in those days, like, there was Al Cohn was a cult hero amongst white saxophone players. Right. And so I would go to this drum shop, Ellis Tolan's, was a drummer who had a drum shop, and he had jam sessions for visiting musicians. And I talk to guys, I meet people like Frank DeBerry was like a big Al Cohn guy, and he told me which records to listen to. But if I back up to, I remember my first day with the tenor saxophone. I had a Kahn 10M, a Brillhart number 4 rubber mouthpiece, and a symmetric cut reed. I think it was a 2.
Wow.
I remember precisely what I had.
That's amazing.
And I knew exactly the sound I wanted. I had the sound in my ear.
Was it the sound of Al Cohn, basically?
Kind of something like that, that kind of genre. Uh-huh. And so after about 4 hours, I had a proximity of that sound. Now, I tell, young people, I said, you have to have an idea of what you want to sound like. You can practice 10 hours a day. It doesn't mean anything unless you have some concept, whatever the concept is. So that was my beginning. And it was pretty funny because I got pretty good at it in a way. I got a decent sound. I could usually get a decent sound out of any instrument. And I never played proper low register. I always played kind of like a subtone. I never played a normal classical quote or legit or
right.
So I remember years later was in high school auditioning for a scholarship, and I go before this panel, and I'm playing a tenor, clarinet, and flute, right? Which in those days that was pretty unusual. So I play the tenor, I play a little etude from the Universal Saxophone Book.
Sure, the Paul DeVille method.
Whatever.
Yeah.
And play a little clarinet, a little flute, and the guy says, "Oh, can you tell me about playing subtone on the saxophone?" And I didn't know anything. It's just the way I played. I had a teacher. His name was Tony Deanna. He was a local guy, played gigs, and his concept was prepare me to make a living. So
by playing all the woodwinds, basically,
well,
all the single
playing
reeds.
The saxophone and the flute. I mean, saxophone and the clarinet, flute wasn't involved in. But what he did teach me was to transpose. So now I can transpose alto parts.
Right.
Which, this is all coming back to me. It's kind of weird, probably rambling on and on, but it's kind of funny to me. I remember he sent me in on a gig at the Schubert Theater. The union made them have a band, kind of an orchestra, 10, 12-piece orchestra. And play for in intermission for the shows, not musical shows, but
right. Acts.
And yeah, I remember I go. He sends me in there, and there's some famous actors back there, And I go out to play. I'm reading the stock. Celeste Holmes was the star of the show.
Wow.
And so I'm playing with this band. The band leader's name was Bernie Burrell. I never forgot it.
Bernie Burrell.
Perfect name. He was a violin player. And he makes an announcement. He said, "This is a 10-piece band. I want it to sound like 10 pieces, not 20 pieces." And I'm playing the one saxophone, and which is like a stock arrangement, and I have to play the alto part, which has the melody, and a quasi society band sound.
Right.
So that was. So anyway, Tony was really cool. I mean, he. He was preparing me for the real world. And I started thinking about it years and years later. I'm in New York. I'm rehearsing with a band at DiPietro Studios. You've probably been
there. Yeah.
And in comes Dizzy Gillespie with his band. He's rehearsing his band for I think it was a benefit for Al Haig trying to raise money for his defense fund. He was on trial for killing his wife or something. So anyway, he's getting ready to rehearse, and he had two baritone parts, and one of the guys didn't show up, and he said, well, you know, they said, anybody play the baritone? I said, no, but I can transpose baritone parts. So I'm playing in the band, and Moody was in the band. Moody couldn't believe it. Moody thought I was a, you know, total genius or something. Like he, till many years, 50 years later, or how many years later, he never forgot that I actually played the baritone part and in the band. And so all this stuff was kind of interesting, you know, when I hadn't thought about this in so many years, because I was able to perform that, thinking of the transposition. Right.
So you never know, I mean, you know, how things that you learn early on, these technical abilities, can somehow just pop up at some point and, you know.
It was interesting, because it really helped me out, because when I first moved to New York, I didn't, you know, I got a gig in a place called Gilbert's in the mountains.
Oh, I remember Gilbert's very well.
And it was a weekend gig.
Oh, sure.
And part of the gig was you had to play a dance set, which right. means I had to play alto
Charts.
Parts on the
right.
tenor.
Right. Sure.
I mean, a show, not a dance set, but a show. We had to play a show. And so he prepared me for the real world, right. in a sense.
Right. Right.
And but I really
right.
kind of rejected the real world. And but, you know, it came in handy. But that's how I got started. And
but you know, there's something I think to be drawn from this, that even though you've devoted the majority of your, certainly your adult life, to being a jazz artist and focusing on that, that at various points in your life, in order to make ends meet, you had to call on these qualities that you learned, being able to play other instruments, being able to transpose and read, and certainly your work in later years with some of the big bands and some of the TV orchestras, the Tonight Show Band, the Dick Cavett Show Band. I mean, you had to be able to sit down and
do something. I mean, I wasn't a great reader, but I could do it. And like I remember, when 1967, I got a gig playing in a club 6 nights a week in Lincoln Center area. It was called La Boheme,
right.
it was called, and it paid grand total $5 a night, 6 nights a week. That's $30. Now, I mean, people say, "Well, it was 1967," but even so, come on.
That's
the great thing. It had a great drummer came with it, Jimmy Lovelace. And I had to find a bass player for $5 a night, which was my job. But to play every night, man, like I was playing every night. But I ran out of money at some point, and I would send in Dave Lehman to sub for me. Meanwhile, I would do I could do a Broadway show sub, and I'd go in for a few nights and I'd do something maybe for Frank West or for somebody, and I make enough bread to go back and do my jazz gig. So
right.
I mean, it was so you're right. Like, I was very impressed the time when I did something at your school.
Right, that was a
that
number of years ago.
You had a band. You had a, I know what you called it. You had a band that played, kind of like a band that would prepare somebody to do.
I think we had a studio orchestra
yeah,
at the time,
right, yeah.
and plus the big jazz yeah. big band. Yes,
the
wow,
studio orchestra was
that.
Very impressive because, like, okay, now these kids, they can get a gig,
yeah.
and just like everybody wants to play, you know, be like, you know, great, you know, jazz saxophonists don't want to double or anything,
right?
And they all become teachers teaching other kids that can't get a gig. So basically,
right.
if you give somebody some skill,
right?
And you know, you're right. It was very helpful. A lot of the things I did as a beginner were very helpful. Play a wedding, I had to play a melody. I had to play a song. In those days, you played songs,
and you had to play harmonies and backgrounds. And
well, I didn't do a lot. I wasn't that good at that. But I mean, at least I could play a melody. I'm 15 years old. You know, I just started playing. I could play a song. My first gig was an Italian serenade at 12 in the morning with an accordion. I had to play I'm Gonna Move for Love, you know, for $5.
Right.
You know, that was.
But you have to ultimately you have to play with rhythm sections, and even if it's not a jazz gig, you're still playing and fitting in the context of a rhythmical scenario, and that in itself is a
and you're learning how to phrase a melody,
right?
Trying to get a sound out of, you know, trying to get a sound, something that sounds good, and you know, and it's something that's kind of missing. So a lot, the whole thing had changed. So that's really going back. We know we're talking about 1955, 56, and you know, and that's
right. But those lessons bring up a point. So much of my website is devoted to not only woodwind playing, but to also doubling in specific. And the point is that there are so many wonderful jazz saxophone players today, young guys coming up through school who have tremendous facility, harmonic knowledge, and really, you know, can play their instrument quite well. But unless you couple that with skills that might also be necessary in order to survive, in order to do your art, that sometimes the end result is not so, doesn't work out the way we'd like it. So, I mean, whether you knew it or not, I mean, you were being prepared to have those other skills to supplement you until you could, you know, step forth as a jazz artist in its entirety
in
life.
When I was young, like, I'm talking about like in high school times, and I'm, you know, I really wanted to be the next Charlie Parker. And shortly, it didn't take me too long to realize it was probably not going to happen. So I started to think in terms of preparing myself to be more of a utility musician, you know, to get a gig. But then, after a couple of months, I said, "Well, wait a minute. You know, if the criterion was to be the next Charlie Parker, we wouldn't have anybody playing.
Right.
So what's the point? I mean," then I realized. I said, "Well, the important thing is to be able to, you know, have a voice as a jazz musician and create a voice." And so I went, I then turned right again and went back to trying to be, you know, develop as a jazz musician. But I did have those little things, you know, I could actually get a proper sound out of clarinet. You mentioned you were talking about like being in Philadelphia with, you know.
Well, the hotbed of certainly orchestral playing in mid-20th century, and Bonnard had been there, and then Ralph McLean was the clarinetist through much of the time when you grew up there. And, you know, in my opinion, the most beautiful
sound.
I didn't know
that much about it. I wasn't that interested, but I had a buffet clarinet and a decent mouthpiece, and one of the students in school studied with Giuliati.
With Tony's father, Giuliati Sr.?
Anthony Giuliati.
Okay, because there was
talking about 19, you know, the, well, let's see, this would be 1960, late 50s.
Oh, or, yeah, Anthony Giuliati was already principal clarinet, but his father was also a big teacher.
I would play duets with him and try to, you know, get some tips from these guys. And I sound okay. I mean, when I moved to New York, I played in rehearsal bands, and Al Regney would be in the band, and I say, "Al, I need a reed. Can you give me a reed?" I had a Casper mouthpiece.
Ah.
It was a really good. I got lucky.
You still have it?
Eddie Daniels has it.
Of course.
He has everyone that ever was made. And anyway, so I said, "Al, give me a reed," and he'd give me, you know, Van Doren. Hard Van Doren reed he had prepared. I was cool for a minimum of 6 months. I never practiced, but when I could sound would sound like a clarinet up to like if I went behind above like an E flat, I'm in really serious trouble.
Yeah, right. But most of us are.
Yeah, but in that range, I mean, I could actually sound like get a credible sound. In fact, when I used to sub for Eddie Daniels. And Thadda Mell's band liked to do both chairs, but when I subbed for Eddie, I had to play lead clarinet, and I did pretty good. You know, I was able to
cover that.
I was able to get the, you know, a proper sound.
Was there ever any time during this period when you already established on flute and tenor, and you know, like I said, you could be creditable on clarinet? Was there ever a time you thought about becoming more of well, quote unquote, is the traditional studio doubler, like what Phil Bodnar, Romeo Penkway, George Marge represented?
No.
Okay.
I'll tell you why.
Okay.
I did a lot of rehearsal bands and some good ones in New York, you know, interesting ones, like Chuck Israels had a band, and Harvey Estrin played, you know, first alto, and Chuck wrote a lot of stuff for me to play flute on. And I mean, I remember Harvey would sight read everything, you know, he never made a mistake. I'm scuffling, well, the rest of us are scuffling, but
yeah, right.
Anyway, so Harvey sends me, he would send me in on gigs, you know, like I was doing a TV, New York crime TV show thing, and I'm playing the flute and improvising my ass off for like 10 minutes, and which was really stupid because the composer would just use little snippets of that throughout the whole show, and we only get paid once. But anyway, right. I had fun. And I said, Harvey, why did you send me in? You know, he said, because you're the best guy. And I was really, you know, honored, because Harvey was the guy. I mean, he
was a very meticulous player.
I mean, he was a great, I mean, when I think of doublers, I think of him. Anyway, so he would send me in on gigs, and then one time I was playing some kind of a jingle or whatever it was, I'm playing the saxophone, and I get a thing from the booth, less personality.
So
I began to realize, I said, well, you know, this kind of goes against my principles. And so basically, whatever commercial work I did, like even in Los Angeles, I did primarily on flute. Some of them didn't know I played the saxophone, because playing flute is a different thing, it's a different challenge.
Right.
And it's like saxophone is my kind of certain voice that I don't want nobody to tell me what, you know, they want my voice to be.
Right.
Like it's just, they just want a note relatively in tune and in time.
Right.
And what Harvey used to say, you're either sharp or out of tune, you know, that kind of, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Whatever that was.
That's called shtick.
Yeah. I was like, I realized that, you know, I had some good experiences, but it wasn't what I really wanted to do. But as you mentioned, it was a way to subsidize a jazz career.
Right.
I didn't have to even teach. I didn't have to do anything. I just could play my instrument. And
right.
Like, even when I did gigs that I didn't particularly be crazy about, I could always find things to do. Let me try another fingering for the middle D on the saxophone.
Right.
Or how if I do this, or try this, or try
right.
that.
Do you think that your flute playing has infused your saxophone playing in some way, has helped it, and vice versa in learning
okay.
these instruments?
I mean, I tell young people, I tell my, even my grandson, I said, look, playing the flute is a great help for the saxophone. It really, because you're preoccupied with air, and the flute is a, it's really, I mean, it used to be like people play the clarinet and then they play the saxophone, but
right.
the flute is even better because it's, you know, that, you know, you can really blow, you know, you can really put a lot of air into it because, it, you know, to get the resonance that you want. And so the flute playing really helped me. And in my young days, I had 1 year of a really great teacher, Murray Panitz.
Well, he was the wonderful principal flute of the Philadelphia Orchestra, who succeeded William Kincaid.
Yeah, and anyway, I mean, I wasn't a good student. I wasn't interested in learning the flute. I was more interested in trying to play, find my voice as a jazz player. I hang out. I wasn't serious. But when Murray Panitz, my first lesson, I played so bad, man. I get the worst sound that I can imagine, and he probably was thinking, what's wrong with this guy? And he started from the beginning. He taught me, I never learned any of this stuff. He taught me the overtone series on the flute and this concept of the jaw being relaxed, basically saying that like every note has a slightly different embouchure. And it's like a floating kind of feeling. So every week, man, I was getting better and better. You know, he thought he was a genius. Of course, like after a couple of months, I was, you know, I was sounding pretty good. But the point being is that I use those things on the saxophone, because I was able to do like, you know, three octave jumps like nothing on the, I'm using the same concept of flute playing on the tenor.
Right, but the air is the core principle there in helping
that.
Yeah,
the air is, you know, that's another aspect of it, but I mean, for what I learned from him, I was able to work on my own, you know, and again, listening to the sound, I was fortunate enough to hear William Kincaid in person. The enormous sound. I mean, it was like, you could hear him in the orchestra. It was like the weight of the low register was incredible. And I heard his farewell recital, which was, I thought was great because I never forgot it, playing this small room. It was like a recital hall. And he was playing the Hindemith. And the slow movement, he starts on a B. He hit the B and he hit it like a quarter tone flat, and he slid up to it like Johnny Hodges.
Really?
I mean, he smiled like he had a smile. And I thought it was. In fact, I ran into the kid that was a page turner at that concert at Phil Unger's place. He remembered that concert. He was turning pages at that time, and But his sound was, you know, the vibrato was something I used to transpose the vibrato in my head. I'd be like, I hear a sound, and I said, but if only the vibrato was like a little different, you know, I'd be perfect. And that kind of, right. It's kind of arrogant, but that's what I would do. Right. But I mean, I was, you know, and I moved to New York, I had nothing but time, and I would listen to, I'd listen to Julius Baker records and, Ron Paul, there was a certain thing that Ron Paul had, kind of darkness and sound, a richness that I really liked. And Tom Neifinger, when I first heard him, and I said, wow, that's the kind of sound I'd like to get. So when I was doing this stuff, like in Chuck Israel's band, I was trying to emulate that kind of stuff, because right. He was writing like Stefan Volpe shit, you know what I mean?
I see.
And like, so so it was like, I really began to realize that I want to develop my own language and my own concept of flute playing, my own tradition, because the saxophone tradition is huge.
Right.
I mean, it's enormous. Flute doesn't have much of a jazz tradition. There's some great players, like Frank West probably being the ultimate, I use the term quintessential jazz flutist, because he had all that integrity, instrumental integrity. And but anyway, I felt like, well, I don't want to play the same licks I play on the saxophone or play it on the flute. I want to create a world. So I got into.
So this was a conscious decision on your behalf.
It was. Yeah, I began to realize it, and then it became a conscious decision that I wanted to utilize the sound of the instrument and the tradition of the flute. Not as a jazz instrument, but as a, you know, like the French tradition,
right.
You know, like that really worked well because of, you know, the that style of music
and the expressivity and the flexibility.
Yeah, I mean,
that
it's
you need.
Perfect for improvising.
Yeah,
and then I years and years later got into the Japanese concepts, but basically I tried to become a narrative player. I always thought in terms of creating a scenario, telling a story. You know, like Lester Young would say, "Where's the story?" But you know,
right.
I'm trying to paint a picture, and that till this day is. And the sound of the flute is such that it lends itself. You can play one note and tell a story.
Right.
Play a couple notes, and so that's through the years.
And may I just to jump inside. You have a huge sound on tenor. I mean, did that also infuse your flute playing, the sense that I want to get a big sound on flute as well? Because, I mean, both instruments, you have tremendous resonance. And
I think you're right. I didn't think of it. Occasionally I would think about it and say, well, I really like, I remember there was a flute player. I ran into a bunch of flute players of Phil Unger's, and anyway, one of them, I said, wow, you have a really fat sound. So I was thinking, I said, well, it's because I play the tenor. Tenor has, at least the way I play it, I hear, you know, a fat sound. So the flute, I do. That's why, that's probably one of the reasons for gold, because gold has a little bit more of that.
Right,
quality.
And also gives you a little more resistance to blow against as well than the silver, perhaps.
It doesn't. It's not as shimmery. So I used to play a Powell, silver Powell, and when I was really trying to be closer to more like Julius Baker, but of course I couldn't. But I mean, conceptually,
right.
And it was really great. It really worked well in the studio situation because it was, you know, the pitch was really right on and everything.
Right. But there's something else I want to bring out, because in meeting so many of the younger woodwind players, potential doublers, from a teaching standpoint and just sometimes as a collegial situation, there seems to be, and maybe this is perpetuated by the schools, a segregation between those who play woodwinds in a classical style and those who play jazz saxophone. And here you are talking on both levels about the great, you know, jazz saxophone traditions that infused your playing and the great classical flute playing that infused your life, and you're not making a difference in treating it all as one and how they can merge, and yet schools really do segregate that. I think the point is, here's someone who's had a great career as a jazz musician, also been able to do some studio work, some other work to supplement, and you're still, if you don't mind me saying, at 76, still passionate about music making, still continuing to look to evolve, so that those who are young and maybe talented jazz saxophonists, or those who are talented woodwind players looking to play saxophone in order to work more as a doubler, that they are not mutually exclusive.
Yeah, the only thing I could say is that the limitation is that it's like saxophone is destroys the flute, and you, as you know.
Well, I'm sure. Well,
okay, so that's. I mean, I'm.
Yes. Yeah.
Once in a while, I'll make a mistake. I'll be doing a gig, and I'll be playing the tenor. You know, in my trio, I play really hard, and I play too many tunes before I pick up the flute, and then I say, oh, man, I should have programmed this a little differently, because now one thing I learned through the years is, like, people ask me about that. Well, how do you go from playing this tenor and then pick up the flute? So you have to, first thing you have to do is, when you pick up the flute, you say, I'm a flute player. I never saw a saxophone before.
Right.
I'm a flute player.
And you have to play at that level.
And then you realize, when you hit that note and it's not exactly the way you wanted it to be, that you have to trust it and relax, don't panic.
Right.
And say, well, It'll be fine, and it'll be cool. It might take a minute, but there, you know, like, if you're, I put it this way: if you want to be, if you're a flute player and a classical flute player, and, you know, I wouldn't mess around with the saxophone unless you're really interested in pursuing that aspect.
That's right. You have to really love the music to want to do it. If you're just doing it for the money, no. It's going to destroy your flute playing, and vice versa. But when you said, well, it takes you a minute to get it back, but that's because of years of practice and also the way one practices. So can you share with us a little bit about how you practice the flute and saxophone, maybe how you warm up on them, because that's so essential in developing good habits and the ability to play for long hours on the instruments.
Well, basically, first thing I do is I always play the flute first, and because you have to find a little aperture, whatever you want to call it.
And to have the sensitivity.
Yeah. I might just play some A's, middle A's, just keep, you know, over and over again where it starts to sound okay, or maybe a B, and then I might just play use it like a lip, kind of like, just trying to get that little focus in the
right, and not forcing it to focus, just letting it find itself.
And then once I get that, then I can go and do the more yeast, the boring more yeast, you know.
Well, you're talking about De La Sonorite, you know, some of those exercises.
You know, do the descending thing, and you do that, and then I will maybe play some long notes in the low register, might try to do a little few vowel movements, you know, and then overtones. And
right. But the first little moment where you're just trying to find that A or B using an air attack, it sounded like.
It's like almost, usually almost more of a lip than, you know, even like, instead of.
Right, in other words, letting it find itself rather than forcing it with a premeditated setup.
Anyway, I'm a little kind of messed up, but anyway, so that basically, I did very.
Let me just interrupt and say that Lou's, whatever playing Lou's doing today is just, he's in pain because he hurt his shoulder a few days ago and is in not great shape with his shoulder, so he's doing us some big favors by even holding the instruments up, and thank you.
Yeah,
for doing
so I mean,
that.
Like, you know, I do really fundamental things, and then there's a Kincaid little exercise, a warm-up exercise. But it takes a long time, and, like, actually, the problem is that by the time you've done the warm-ups, there's no time left to do anything else. But,
well,
but at least, put it this way, if I'm on the road and I don't have, you know, and I try to find, like, even if it's 10 or 15 minutes to play the flute before I play the saxophone, saxophone will take care of itself. If you have a reed, it works.
Right.
And then, because it's not as nearly as sensitive. But I hate to say that, but the flute is a killer.
When you perform with your trio, which is your trio is generally a bass player and a drummer, and you like to play a lot of times without any miking at all, and so that really requires a lot musically, which I want to talk about, but also from an instrumental standpoint, that you have to project your sound. With a bass player and a drummer with no mic on the flute. The saxophone, it's sort of understandable. You could perhaps get it, but to be able to project that sound over a bass and a drum with the flute with no mic in a concert hall, that's really quite something. When did you sort of get into that approach to playing and not using mics? Was that always your approach?
Well, for a while. You know, it depends on the situation, depends on the room. You know, if it's when you have a beautiful sounding room, then you can relax and play. If it's not, it's kind of dead, then it's better to play with a microphone because you start overplaying and overdoing it. But I mean, it's like, am I allowed to stand up?
Sure.
Okay, but like, you know, you basically, see what, if I just try to, I'm into this, you know, everything from here. You know, I'm really preoccupied with putting a lot of air, and it's all from here. I try to be relaxed here,
right? But, and all from the lower abdomen area,
yeah, and that kind of thing. Right. And like always thinking about, like, if you're in a hall, thinking about hitting
the
back wall. Joe Farrell and I used to talk about that. Like, I was one of the few people he actually talked to. He didn't talk to people, but I was like his sub and stuff. We were like. He was help me out, and I talk about it. I said, yeah, you know, I'm thinking about hitting that wall like a martial arts thing. You're looking past the thing. So I don't want to mess your mic up. So anyway, I'm constantly, you know, aware of pushing the sound.
Right. And that's similar for your saxophone as well.
Well, saxophone even more so, because saxophone, it gets like. Interesting thing, when I heard Don Byas play, I mean, recordings, I only heard him play once live, and he was so drunk, it was kind of strange, but I said, wow, this guy, he's got this big sound, and he's low register, so great, and it's not harsh, it's loud but full, and this, I'm trying to think of a way how I could develop that, and I took I took the Moyse thing.
Huh. You mean know, some of those exercises from Dillis and
Arte? Yeah, and I adapted the Moyse. See if I can do it without too much pain. Okay, so instead of, I just would do like, just
we're gonna have you sitting down playing this today because of the shoulder problem.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
So
I'll do the best I can.
Do whatever you
get
can.
An idea.
Yeah.
So starting on the G, and I'm talking. I'm not using any bottom pressure. You know,
right, gradually,
which is
down
cool.
To
but when you start to get really down to the low
low
one,
B, and
then you
oh,
get like
the
like
truth serum. Whatever.
And so it's like, so I started working on that, and then sound got really big. Big and you know, like I could see if I can find a position to play, and like, with Danny Banks warm up.
Oh, really?
I got that from him.
Wow.
He used to play Stravinsky.
Yeah.
Subtone.
That's fantastic. But, on the baritone?
Yeah.
Wow.
Anyway, so it's just like trying to get the air. So I'm playing louder, soft, but still I want energy. It's like a chi, Chinese Tai Chi, you know, like power
the,
from
right,
here.
Right, with the power from the hotter
yeah.
area.
So I mean, yeah. I don't know. I just developed, and I developed a quick breath thing. Because when you're playing jazz music, you don't have a lot of time, or any kind of music, but you're playing it. And so if I can, So it's like, I can take a quick breath, and I don't need, and if you take a quick breath, you get almost as much as a long breath. I'm sure you figured
yeah,
that out.
Yeah, well, that takes a while to figure out, and it's not something that happens just on the moment. And what about the use of vibrato, which on the saxophone, I mean, flute, we understand it, especially in America, no question. Yeah. Flute player is going to learn to use vibrato. But the saxophone, in the jazz idiom, today, less and less I hear it being used by younger players, at least in a manner where you can decipher it as a vibrato rather than as a quiver,
well,
let's say.
I look at it in another way. I always try to tell, you know, young people, I said, you know what, you play, and when you end a note, the nuance is your signature. And so when you play, always think about the ending. Try to have enough air so when you end a note, you can control the ending and create your signature. And whether it's vibrato, whatever your nuance is, and it's something that nobody talks about.
People are more concerned with beginning the notes. Usually,
yeah, yeah.
Or beginning of, that's interesting.
The first thing you hear is the beginning of the note, but also the last thing you hear is the ending of the note. And a lot of players you hear play really great, and they end a note in a really stupid nuance and ruins everything. So Coleman Hawkins said, listen to yourself when you play. So, which he did, obviously. And, you know, you control the end of the note. You were talking about you know, playing without a chordal instrument and trying to make sure the harmony is
right.
Cool.
We were talking yesterday about this.
That's part of it. It's like, right. So if I'm playing like, trying to like you know, even as far as vibrato, I mean, it's like, I don't know. There's obviously, because you're playing like, but vibrato, and I try to make you think of it in a natural way. It's like,
right.
It's almost like almost something that comes at the end of the notes. It's like on the ballad. I like it to be natural. Most right. guys like, okay, if you hear a Coltrane play, like, I mean, it's boring, right?
Well, it's much less. You're much less aware of vibrato when it's much more contained in it, and that seemed to be
if you hear Coleman Hawkins, it's the same thing. You'll play like. I mean, it's like there's more involvement in the sound and expression, but nowadays it's like it's gotten to. People play, first of all, they play the saxophone with the neck strap way down and closing off the throat.
Right, so right. Well, now you're playing right now without any strap at all, yeah. Which sometimes you do, but when you do use a strap, the idea is that it should not compromise your windpipe or
try
your head position.
The same thing.
Right.
And you know how to play like that.
Right, so that you put yourself in a position that you wouldn't talk in, let's say.
Pain. You have to learn to live with pain.
It's all over here.
But, yeah, I fell down the stairs, a stupid thing. But the doctor said it would be okay.
Well, let's hope so.
I hope so. Yeah. Otherwise. But, yeah, like, see, nowadays you go, I see guys on the gigs and they're playing like down here. Like
it's way down, yeah.
Nothing happens.
Right. Well, let's do that standing up because that might be even a more vivid picture for the listening audience.
Okay, for this.
Yeah.
The way I don't like it.
And now how would you position the?
Go up a little bit.
Right. And again, that's all based upon freedom
like
of the larynx.
You're not choking off. Right. Joe Temperley would call me up here. Sometimes you say, how do you look up when you play? I said, well, I usually keep my eyes closed, but I think what you're talking about is that you're opening your throat. You know, it's like. So even with the strap, I'm playing without a strap. In a sense, it just helps me
right.
Basically, I'm trying to. I can tell you how that happened. It's like I was playing this gig in Baltimore, Left Bank Jazz Society, and a loud drummer and really into it, you know. And I had one of those little neck straps like Coltrane used with a little round.
The little clip-ons.
The one that we all use those.
You sure.
And I'm playing. I'm playing like mad, and all of a sudden it broke.
Oh, the strap itself broke.
Yeah. Wow. So I caught the saxophone. I didn't want to stop playing because I was really into it. So I just had to play like this, you know. I had to play like that. And so interesting thing happened. My sound got better. I said, wait a minute. I my throat opened up, and right. So that was my lesson. I said, oh, from then on in, I was really aware of the fact of making sure I didn't cut off the air.
Right, and you do the same thing, I imagine, on flute, with not constricting and not...
Yeah, right. You try not, you know, and the interesting thing is, like, I never looked at pictures and stuff, but then I started to notice that that my position came closer to like Hawkins, and it wasn't like looking in the mirror and stuff, but it went from that over here.
Yeah. Oh yes, I see.
That or
right,
know, like,
right. The different pictures of Lou in his studio.
Yeah,
that.
Yeah. From, so I mean, like there's older ones, and so I mean, like it's kind of you know. I think it's an important lesson. Sometimes, you know, when you get older, you feel you could just tell somebody. I hear somebody play a really good player. I said, you know, if you just lifted your neck up about like this much, sound would be 20% better. They don't really care.
Well,
But again, like Coleman Hawkins, listen to yourself when you play and. It sounds simple, but people don't listen to themselves.
Right. Now, you've been invested so many years with, in a sense, paying homage and reverence to the great tenor players of like Hawkins and Don Byas and Ben Webster and certainly Sonny Rollins and even Coltrane at certain times. And yet you've developed your own style and sense of it. Can you discuss, was this a conscious thing on your behalf when you began tenor playing since you came out of the Philadelphia hotbed with so many great tenor players there, like you mentioned, and Larry McKenna and Billy Root, Ziggy Vine, Al Cohen. I mean, all these great tenor players, and there's a tradition. So did that sort of help move you to like going back and studying these players? And then, of course, it sort of all filtered into developing your own style.
Not exactly. What basic?
There, I had a question all set up, and all you had to say, "Yeah."
No, I mean, it was a good point what you said. Yeah. Those are inspirational guys, and right. You know, in a way. But what happened to me was, I went through my. Those are the guys that you know, like my earlier period, and. I took some lessons from Larry, who was really great.
Larry McKenna.
I saw him not too long ago.
Who's still active and vibrant playing. Today in Philly.
No, he's still playing. I said, Larry's great. He's still playing with great integrity. And, you know, anyway, that's special. And you know, a lot of the guys, there were some great guys. Most of them had drug problems, and they couldn't leave Philadelphia. And problem. But anyway, I went on my path, right? I started out. You know, like I said, Al Cohen was my first influence, and you know, I used to go hear him and Zoot and all that stuff. And then I got into Sonny Rollins, and then Coltrane came on the scene, and I really got into that. I used to be a pretty good imitation, in fact. And in fact, I played a little snippet of something I played when I was 20 or 21 for somebody. I said, "Who's that?" And he says, "That sounds like is that Train?" I said, "No, it was me." But yeah, surely I realize that's a dead end. Come on, man, you can't be. It's okay when you're 20 years old, but you got to grow out of it. You have to find who you are. And then I think I mentioned it to you at a point that I knew a trombone player named was Leo Fogel in Philadelphia, who was a jazz aficionado kind of guy. You know, he knew a lot of history, and he invited me to his place and played me. Recordings of great tenor players, and being ignorant, I mean, I heard Al Cohen and Zoot Sims, but I never spent much time listening to Lester Young, put it that way.
Right.
So anyway, he started out with Prez, and man, classic Lester Young is, you know, it's like Mozart. I mean, it's
perfect.
Perfection. It's total perfection, and every aspect of it, you wouldn't want to change a note. You know, it's just incredible. So I'm listening to this, wow, and that sound. They said he had a small sound. It wasn't a small sound. He just didn't use much vibrato, so it was different
diameter of sound. Yeah.
But it was a resonant sound. I said, wow, that's great. And then he plays Ben Webster. Now, Ben Webster, boy, that's something, man. I listened to that. It's an amazing sound. I can give you a side story. If you're interested, I was hired to do Black, Brown, and Beige. John Faddis asked me to do this with
the Carnegie Hall?
It wasn't the Carnegie Hall, but it was another thing for a Ralph Ellison posthumous book release party, if that makes sense.
Huh.
So I'm playing Ben Webster's part. and a lot of shit was written out, like his cadenzas and stuff. They're supposedly written by Duke, but I'm sure it was whatever it was, kind of a guide. So I was really like trying so hard to be respectful and to do it right. And I got into that world, the Ben Webster world. It's a dangerous place. You can't get out of it.
It's enticing.
Oh, it's like, yeah. I mean, it's like just to get the essence of the sound, put you in a place that it took me a month to get out of it. I couldn't escape. It's like, I mean, if you please let. Whatever. I mean, and you start to get into that world and it's just like envelops you. Toshiko calls it tragic beauty, which is what it is. I mean, even he would cry sometimes. And it's like, so I mean, I learned my lesson. That's stay away from that, you know, because it's like being a method actor, and right. Then you can't get out.
Not to stay away from Ben Webster, but stay away from.
Don't go. Don't try to enter that world because you might not be able to. You might be like one of those Twilight Zone things,
right.
And like you're into this world and you're there. But then that impressed me. Then he played. He played Don Byas. I said, man, nobody plays a saxophone that great. You know, it's just like, it was ridiculous. And then he played a few people and got to Coleman Hawkins. I couldn't get it. It was too hard for me. I was too immature to appreciate Hawkins because the sound and the time feel and an incredible harmonic concept. I mean, it's like, it would overwhelm me, so I had to put that away in the back of my brain for a while. And a couple of years later, the light bulb went off, and I said, "Well, that's the source of everything." But so that was my kind of introduction to kind of a little bit of the history. And then I did some more investigation. I discovered Chew Berry, and I discovered this and that, and I started to listen and try to absorb the elements of each player that I really identify with or really like.
Did you do a lot of transcribing in order to do that, or was it more just listening and trying to get the feeling from
it was like an osmosis thing.
Right.
Because you pick up licks and stuff, but I was just trying to get the essence of the music.
Right. Because
there's only 12 notes, I mean. And then when I went to hear my hero, in the 60s, early 60s, I heard Sonny Rollins, and I said, man, it was like, I really had it. I said, oh, I know that. That's Hawkins, that's Lester, that's by, that's not by, so he wouldn't do that. It would be maybe Chew Berry, maybe something which I detected. And it only reinforced my idea that that's the way you find who you are. It's like, it takes a long time, especially nowadays, because it's not like you're playing all the time. You're not playing every six nights a week.
Right.
You're playing, and so it takes longer for jazz musicians to develop. Like we're in the early days, you're 25, you're already developed. I find that it takes about your 40s to find your voice. It takes that long.
Well, that may be true not only for jazz artists, but I think even classical artists and you know, one of my pet peeves, I know this is sort of switching gears quite a bit, but my pet peeves in academia was that people get hired in their 20s and 30s as professors. And I always thought, that's ridiculous. I think actually I became a professor somewhere around 39 or 40 years old. I mean, just coincidentally, and I'm not saying it because it happened to me, but I thought, how can you possibly teach 20-year-olds, if you're a 20-year-old or a 30-year-old, about life and stuff until you've evolved? And I think for any discipline that you're dealing with in a serious manner, that a certain amount of life experience is necessary to accumulate the influences that sort of end up making you what you are. And I think that's, in a sense, what you're saying.
It's like I remember playing in, I didn't think a lot about it, but I was playing in Nice one time, and Jimmy Heath was there, and he said, man, I hadn't heard you play in a while. Man, your sound got so much richer, and sounds like blah, blah, blah. He said, but that's because you're 40. Huh. And then I started to think about that, and I think one of the aspects of it is that when you start to get around 40, I'm sure it's different with everybody, but you start to accept your idiosyncrasy. When you're young, you don't like your idiosyncrasy. That little thing that you do, you don't want it there because it's too personal. I mean, like, how to describe it? You want everything to be without that little dirt or whatever you want to call it.
Or maybe trying to emulate your hero of the moment and trying to say, well, I'm not there yet, or it's not that way, so you...
Yeah, it's like, you know, it's like when you, at a certain point you say, well, this is who I am. And another interesting thing that I just thought of is like when you first start playing, within the first year, you develop a certain sound, and then you go through all this stuff. You go for this, and this, and you eventually come back to where you started, basically. I mean, that's obviously better, but I mean, the basic concept, your initial approach sometimes is closer to the truth than all the other stuff.
Interesting. Wouldn't it be interesting if we had recordings of us in that first year to go back to and make that? But there's...
I have not the first year, but I had an interesting recording of... I was in a jazz contest in school, and my band came in last place, and my group came in last place. However, I got a gig. Somebody hired me, and he liked the way I played.
Right, as a result of hearing that. There it is.
So anyway, I got a gig with this French piano player, Bernard Payfair of Philadelphia.
Oh, I've heard of Bernard Payfair.
So he has this big concert, and rehearsing. And his thing would be do like traditional way of playing a song, and then he'd take it out and whatever. This is like 1960, I guess, something like that. 61, maybe.
Right.
So anyway, I'm trying to play like I Ain't Misbehaving or something, like one of those tunes. I'm trying to sound like Ben Webster. I listen to the recording, it sounds like Lester Young. So then I realized, I said, wow, there's a big gap between what you think is coming out of your instrument
and what actually is.
As you get more experience, the gap narrows, but then again, there is a gap. And it was my first revelation that what I thought I was doing was not exactly what was coming out.
Right, which leads us in a little bit to a question about your equipment, because equipment does have an influence on the way you feel about your playing and to a degree what you sound like.
Sure.
So can you share with us a little bit about your equipment and how you arrived at this equipment?
Okay, well, basically, I told you what I started with. But years later, when I got into Coltrane, I started to play a Meyer. Meyer 6 was a 3.5 reed, which is interesting. The reason was that the rubber Meyer has a kind of a brightness, and like which you could get that kind of sound.
Emphasizing the upper partials.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
And it was, boy, you could play a lot of stuff on it. The resistance was not that great. So I used that for a long time. And then I started to hear another sound. I realized that I was going against the grain of the mouth, grain of whatever you want to say, the quality of the mouth. I was trying to hear something different. So then I kind of went through the struggle for not having a mouthpiece, every day trying a different mouthpiece kind of thing. You know, you've been through that, I'm sure.
I think so.
Yeah, okay, we've all done that. So it's like going through hell. But finally, I decided on a rubber link, 7-star rubber link. And I did a little manipulation on the inside, I don't know what I did. But anyway, that was close to sound I was beginning to hear. It was fatter and not as bright. Blah, blah, blah. And I used that. I made a lot of records on that, actually, with the big band and all the records. And
did you do the Duke Pearson big band?
No, the
recording?
Duke Pearson thing was still using the Meyer.
It's still on the Meyer.
I was on the Meyer. Okay. And after that, I switched to the Link. And then at one point, Frank Foster gave me a metal Link, number 8, I think it was. He said, I'm tired of this. He went on to a Lawton. Cause,
right, that's so, right. He played a wide open Lawton.
He said, he used to play a 10 or 10 star link, and then he moved to an 8.
Wow.
And with a hard read. And then he got tired of it. So he gave me the 8. And then when my rubber link wore out, they wore out. And I started playing. Frank Wells adjusted Frank Foster's
The metal
piano. Metal link.
Yeah.
Came up with a 112 opening, is what I play to this day.
Oh.
And
That's not that severe an opening,
no,
actually.
It's between an 8 and an 8 star.
Not even that. That's a 112 tip is not that.
110 is an 8, 115 is an 8 star.
Yeah, that's still. I mean, yeah. I would thought it would have been more open. The amount of volume you get.
The reason I don't, I use a fairly hard read. Because I need a harder read to get, believe it or not, to get this kind of subtone that I do. If I use a soft read, it won't come out.
It'll close up.
Yeah.
Right.
So anyway, that's. So I went on that. That's basically what I'm doing to this day. And I started to use harder reeds. I just started using Roberto's reeds for medium. And because I'm waiting for, I've been propagandist for Rico for a long time, Jazz Select, and they were great. I love the design. I'm experimenting now with Roberto's reeds. It's a little brighter, but the resonance is there, and I can play a reed for more than one day,
right,
which is kind of nice.
Yes.
So anyway, that's the equipment that I use.
And this metal link is?
It's a Florida link.
Florida link.
It was actually, this originally belonged to Eddie Lockjaw Davis, but it was a 10 star.
Wow.
And for reasons that I mentioned, I
you brought it down.
I had it. This was basically done by Ohio Ralph Morgan.
Ralph Morgan, wow, who was a
Ralph Morgan did a lot of work for. He was an amazing guy.
Yeah, and he worked at the Selmer factory for years and really knew the history of the instrument.
You should have interviewed him.
Yeah.
He never wanted to do a mouthpiece more than 110, but he let me go.
Right.
You
okay.
Know, so
And you have a beautiful super balance that's gold plated here. 52,000?
Yeah.
Series.
One thing I have to mention, is that anything you do differently with the key heights or keys? Well, feel this.
The E flat and C.
Just feel the E flat key. I have to tighten this.
There's some tension on that.
Yeah, it has to be.
Right, or it flips open too.
I have to do a lot of tension on this key, on a B, on the side C key. I still need a heavier spring because when I play, they just go nuts.
I see.
So I have to do that.
And this is the other question bringing up. I know you've been very involved working with Tomoji Hirokata in New York since Tomoji arrived here, really, in the country, and he's a magnificent repair person. And you're very fastidious about all your instruments. I mean, you really are. I mean,
He told you that?
I know that. Yes, he did. but I think that's a great quality. And can you talk a little bit about it? Because a lot of players I've seen, I'm surprised, don't take care of their instruments as fastidiously as you do, for instance, Lee. I know I am that way. I'm a type A, and that's the way I am with it. But I think there's something that really is important to understand about having your instruments in great condition and great playing shape in order to really make your practicing and playing as positive as possible.
You don't need any handicaps, put it that way. And the way some people play, it doesn't matter. Others, it does. You know, some people, it's not that. And also, it's shocking that so many players who've been playing for a million years don't understand the basic fundamentals of saxophone repair or what, you know. Jerry Dodgen called me once, and he says, oh man, Tomoji's not here. My my flute, it's not working, and blah, 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 and he explained what it was. I said, Jerry, I tell you what, do you have any cigarette paper? No, what is his girlfriend did, so he got it. I said, okay, take that and put it underneath this thing. Magic. I mean, it's not rocket science. When you're in a row, things happen, so you have to be able to deal with it.
Yes.
And carrying a little light, some kind of a thing you can use as a leak light,
right.
And cellophane, and rubber bands, scotch tape. You can pretty much get through anything.
Right, that's right.
I like the horn, though, because I get insecure. Like a lot of times, I have things, hard things to play. Like I have to. Tosca used to write a lot of low Bs. Beep, oh. And hit the low.
You should have told her don't write low Bs.
I know, but she already wrote.
I see.
Like that, so yeah. I have to hit them and.
And if you're going to play a low B on any of the saxophones, your horn has to be covering.
Yeah, I know. I've had some horrible experiences, having a not cover, and then you have to make terrible adjustments. So Tomozzi, he's very nice to me. He always thanks me after I bug him and I go over there, and he thanks me because he claims that he learned something.
Well, that's why he's such a great repairman. He really does think of it that way.
Because you can't, like I was. I had a problem in Japan this last trip, and I there's a really great repair place, Ishimori.
Yes.
And I brought my horn there in the morning, and they said, okay, pick it up around 6:30, come back, and bring it down. They said, oh, it's not quite ready. Okay, now it's ready, and I play it, and it's not. I said, no, man, it's not happening. And they said, well. We're having a meeting, trying to figure out how to, having a meeting, it's Japanese style, you know, they have meetings. I said, know what it is? You didn't tighten the springs enough. You have to tighten this, and like, because you have to understand the proclivity of the player that you're dealing with.
Right. Now, just feeling your horn, feels very efficient, and the basic springs and the basic stack feel very responsive and not heavy at all. So that's interesting that
it's just the side keys.
That's the side keys to get them a little
heavier.
Because
those are the ones that the turbulence, like they blow open and the notes don't come out properly.
Right.
So I know as soon as I get a horn, I say, okay, I have a tool that Tomozzi made for me where I can
tighten. Spring tension.
Yeah, it's really great. Mm-hmm. So I can do that. Yeah. This one still vibrates. And no matter what, I'm going to...
The side B flat?
I'm going to have to...
Side
C. I'm going to have to...
Oh, the side C. I see.
Yeah, I'm going to have to get a... I don't know what kind of spring to get.
Right.
But anyway...
But it's interesting also looking at your horn how you have some added keys build up here on the side. And also on your palm keys, you've added things. I mean, so you're very concerned about having this customized to make it feel exactly... the way you want it to feel.
Yeah, I thought most people do. I mean, I have two Mark Sixes, and I have a Con Chewberry 1928 gold plated, which has the most amazing sound. I mean, I could blow the walls would crumble. I mean, and any reed
will play.
Because what I came to the conclusion to was that. With the old American saxophones, there was so much resonance in the horn themselves that reeds weren't quite as critical.
That's a very interesting statement. And so many of the players, sax players who I respect, studio type players, doublers, seem to be gravitating more and more back to the earlier horns, which do have a more personal sound and resonance. But that's very interesting because years ago, they would give boxes of 25 reeds.
Yeah.
It would cost just a few pennies. It would make you cry today. And you could also hand select your reeds sometimes.
Right, right,
But yeah, that's interesting. I never really thought of it that way, that because the horns were so resonant that the reeds themselves weren't as crucial as they seem to be today.
Exactly. I think we're trying to
recreate the resonance.
Yeah, well, I'm trying to my vocabulary is starting to leave me, but trying to substitute, or make the reed accommodate the sound that you want, and when it's not exactly in the horn.
That's very interesting.
So I'm really fussy with the reeds because I have to hear, you know, a certain timbre resonance or right. something, and then I have to be able to do what I was talking about, my modified subtone, I call it.
Right.
I mean, it's a loud subtone. It's an oxymoron, I guess.
Right. 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 One thinks of subtone as less than a full sound, yeah. but in effect, it's not. It's more than
a full sound, but it's not a, it's a, it's a less lip pressure.
Yeah, it has a different overtone balance and a different color. Before we wrap up today, there's just one more question I have, and it actually has to do with the creation of your line playing. Because, and I mentioned this to you, I think, yesterday, when you play with a trio, without a chordal instrument, and you're responsible for not only the melody, but the harmony, and then the rhythmic aspect, and yet connecting it all in making a beautiful melodic line of, in your improv. How do you go about practicing to arrive at this? In other words, what devices do you use in your practicing to arrive at, you know, a line that encompasses, that reflects the melody and reflects the underlying harmony there, and in a rhythmically interesting way, so that we don't miss the chordal instrument? Is there any way you practice in particular for that?
I don't do that. I don't practice it, but I think about it, and I did used to think about it. It's just like connecting the phrases. It's like you play a phrase, and I want the next phrase to have something to do with the phrase I played before. It's a conversational reality.
Right.
So you're talking to yourself in a way,
right.
or sometimes you can start thinking about playing duets with yourself.
It's like call and response to it with
yeah,
yourself.
Yeah, so it's because right. so much of jazz music is call and response, and I don't know if there's any way. I think it's more of a conceptualization. And like when you're playing a song, there's always a note that defines the harmony, and you kind of lay for that note. Like what I just played before was like, when I played Indian Summer, it was like obvious, like, you know. You know.
Right,
so
it's as if you're playing behind the singer,
yeah.
and you're the singer also.
Hey, that's exactly it, well
right.
put. It's
right.
kind of like you're yeah. accompanying yourself,
right.
you know, and like you're throwing on the problem I have is when I play with a piano player, that's his job. I'm taking his job, so I have to
right.
be careful.
Right.
It's just, you know, anything you play. You know, like, so like you lay for the notes that, but too much of today's playing, when people play in a trio or without, you know, and then there's too much of a false sense of freedom. So it's not like, it's like too much of not paying attention. You have to pay attention to what you're playing. Like, you know what I mean? And then the rhythmic thing, there's rhythm in the space. Whatever. You know, it's like, there's rhythm, you take a lot of space. So, you know, there's a lot, there's that. I think just like being aware, and like, just, I always get mad at myself when I play and then I'm not connecting the phrases properly if I'm playing. You know, so I'm always I'm trying to get in the habit of doing that.
Right. But what, let's say you're learning a tune. Let's say not a tune that you're familiar with. Someone gives you a new tune, you're playing with a group and whatnot. What is your approach to that? I mean, do you sit at the learn it at the piano first? Do you play through the harmonies from bottom to top and so forth as a process? Is there any type of process, is what I'm asking.
What I learned years and years ago was that if I look at new material, like a lot of time you're on a record date and you say throw to something, you have to play a solo and you don't know the song and you don't even know what's happening. You try to immediately find out where the tonics and dominants are. So when you figure out, because a lot of times the dominants are kind of obscured in the way they're notated. So you have to see, well, if this looks like an F, this looks like an F seventh or an F ninth, but it's going to C major, it's probably a form of G seventh. You know what I mean? So you learn where the points of repose are, where the motion is and where the ending is, where it's going to. So that's one thing to look at. And like, there's certain obvious things when, and like if you have like, you can have like a D seventh chord and it can be interpreted so many different ways, but the melody will tell you if you're playing. So you know that. So you know that you're not going to play an E natural on that chord because it's in the melody, so right. No matter what it says. You look at the melody and you try to figure out what the composer tried to say and try to interpret it and then internalize it. I internalize all my tunes that I play. I've been playing them for years and they're my songs now, because I had a student once and for many years, he was very talented. I never charged him for like 4 years. And he played really good. And he played a melody. He played like. You know, I mean, maybe not quite that bad, but yeah, almost that bad. I said, Michael, what is that? And you're playing it like, you know, make the melody say. Then he finishes the melody and he's off, man. He's cool. You can play all this shit, you know, and like, it's fine, but you have to integrate the melody into the solo. It's not like, okay, this is something we get rid of. Right. Then that's finished. Now we get
now
to
we
fun.
Now do, right, yeah. Right, right. Let you me know, get. Like,
so it's an important thing is to take the songs and like. You know, like, so like you look for, if you like, so you got that this is a note that defined makes a difference. So you find that note, you lay for those notes that, and then when you play, I mean, you can take it to all kinds of different places, but right, you're aware of the melody and how the harmony and the melody right work together.
Right, right. And you know, we had talked about our mutual friend Charles McPherson always talking about finding the best note in the chord, and that's something that Bird always seem to be able to do, and among many, right. But I mean, it's those interesting notes, and it comes from the melody being prioritized, which is what.
See, a lot of times, like a lot of the old songs were written, you know, and some of the composers were terrible. They didn't know harmony at all. But a lot of them knew what they wanted to say, and the jazz guys go and make it like symmetrical and ruin everything.
Right.
Maybe they didn't want it to be like that, you know. And all, you know, some of the composers were really terrible, but some guys were, you know, really good. I was playing this tune. So many people were dying lately, and I started to play this in Japan. Was it? I mean, it's to me, it's ingenious of that, you know, Benny Goodman recorded, but
right.
to be like, well, concert A flat seventh.
Yeah, it's almost like a separate cry into the note. Yeah,
it's beautiful. Yeah. I mean, a lot of composers are really...
By the way, for our audience, some of the younger guys may not know, that's a great tune called Goodbye.
Yeah.
And but you're right. Well, a lot of the great composers who became most prolific in creating the American songbook, people like Gershwin and Richard Rodgers, yeah. and certainly Cole Porter, the masterful harmonic writing, Irving Berlin, who himself had limited.
Yeah, he was probably not the best of those
right,
guys.
But there was so much.
Yeah, I mean,
just
like,
natural.
You can like. It's interesting, like. You know, like the problem with what happened, Bebop had a lot to do with it in a way that they started to do a lot of that stuff.
Substituting.
Get rid of the little sentimentality of it and get it into the 2-5 one half steps and blah, right. blah, blah, blah.
Or in many cases, putting a dominant where it's a sixth chord.
Yeah, well.
Things that, I mean, where it changes the whole complexion.
Here's the one that gets me is like. I mean, who starts a tonic with a seventh? George Gershwin.
Yeah.
And the theory I heard was, now this might be bullshit, but that he was at a party and these guys were getting drunk, and they sang the Happy Birthday and right. the end and many more, you know. So I bet you can't write a song like. They say, okay. It might be
funny.
True because like why would he write a song like a tonic chord and you know like with the seventh in the melody.
I had never heard that story. Well, that's a great that I even might, if it's not I, true, it's a great story.
Yeah, I mean,
what gigs do you have coming up in the new year?
I've got a gig in New Jersey. And then the New Jersey Performing Arts Center.
Oh, the NJ PAC, okay.
Yeah, and the 22nd. Then I go to Charleston, South Carolina for four nights.
And with your trio?
No, I go by myself with okay. a local, well, rhythm section that is not exactly local because they couldn't find people and they're importing people from wherever they can find.
Right.
And I'm still working on my next year. I go to Japan every September with my trio. And I have some stuff, but hopefully it'll pick up.
Right.
But if it doesn't pick up, I just do what I do.
You got this. And do you and Toshiko play much anymore, gig-wise?
Once in a while. We did something at Dizzy's a couple months ago.
Yes.
And... We did a duet tour in Japan, I guess earlier this year, actually in the springtime.
Right.
And you know, we don't do much. She has her projects and I have my projects, but and then we don't, you know, we gave up the band, you know,
about 12, 13 years ago.
Quite a while ago, actually. So she did a recording of her last project was she did a recording of. Poor Game Bess, but she tried to stick to the original forms instead of cutting them down to 8, 8, 8, you know, 8 and 13, to make them
right.
a standard, which made it hard, but she basically perfected, I hate to say this, but she came up with the definitive performance of I Love You, Porgy. She's really worked on it. She really internalized it, you know. She watched the opera and she says, oh, he's a Schillinger writer.
Huh. Well, isn't that interesting? And he was...
Yeah, she picked up on it, man. And she's, and but she said she was so impressed by, you know, the whole musicality of the opera and then the story, and she actually really internalized it, which she hasn't done that to that extent, you know, in a while. She actually was emotionally touched by the whole process.
And, you know, that particular opera was the first large composition, orchestral composition, that, if I'm correct, that Gershwin himself actually orchestrated, and not using Ferdi Groffé.
Yeah.
And the Met has done several, I think, incarnations of it.
Did they do his original?
Yes. The one I heard, I think was in the 80s, if I remember correctly, hearing it at the Met. It was spectacular. And I do remember that because Jimmy Abbata was still in the orchestra and playing in the section, and so it definitely was in the 80s. Okay. But anyway, Lew, thanks.
Okay, it was nice hanging with you, man.
Yeah, it is. Well, lunch is still to come.
Well, I have someone sent me a list of questions for another interview.
Yeah.
And it's so, like, I said, no, I can't. It's so really weird, so it's so refreshing to talk to somebody who knows what they're talking about.
Well, thanks. Likewise.
We could do an interesting thing about this thing, because I knew I was going to do this, and I started thinking about stuff from, like, when I was a kid, and all these years, I'm still 35, you know.
Right. We both are.
Yeah, I mean, I'm still like trying to get it right.
Right.
And I'm still like, and I'm realizing all these periods of all these situations that some are good, some are bad, some I'm proud of, some I wish I could have done better, and all that kind of stuff. And I was thinking, wow, it's kind of scary. So, but it always helps to talk to somebody who knows what they're talking about, which is not always the case. Put it that way.
Well, thanks, and it's been a pleasure, and you know, always learn speaking with you and learn listening to you, and I hope our audience will check out some of Lew's recordings. There's stuff online, but really the best way to get it is to sit down and listen to the CDs and really get the full gist.
I have a
of
new
it.
CD.
Oh, let's. You
I
gave
think
it
I
to.
I gave it to you. No, that's the next. That's almost. That's the.
Ah, yes, sounds. The new one is called Soundscapes.
Soundscapes, as opposed to landscapes or.
Right.
And
this is with your trio.
It's my trio.
Right, and a nice shot of you with the New York skyline in the background.
It's like 8:30 in the evening in front of this pond, and
Central Park. Yeah.
If I stepped back one inch, I'd be in the water. It was not that easy.
Yeah.
So being. Posing is not cool,
man. Right. But anyway, we hope you'll all check out Soundscapes, Lew Tabackin Trio. And thank you, and we'll look forward to seeing you next time when our guest will be Ted Nash. Thank you.